I'll explain this later. I said this last hour, this is one of the few times a year I get to preach with a whole army at my back. Some of you who don't know me, I have three children, two that are in college, one living at home, and this is the time of year where they're fewer and far between now when we're all together. It's been fun. My oldest son, Noah, who's a sophomore in college, when he was 5 years old, we took the family pilgrimage, which for our case was only one time, to the holy city of Orlando, Florida. To visit, you can guess it, Mecca, Disney World. And at that time, my son Noah, who's now, he's 20 years old, and you would not believe it, but at that time, he suffered from a pretty serious condition called BLOCD, Buzz Lightyear Obsessive Compulsive Disorder. You laugh, but it was serious at that time because of a movie called Toy Story. Many boys his age had this affliction. It was Buzz all the time, everywhere. Buzz pillow, Buzz blankets, Buzz stuffed animals, Buzz figures. He slept with them. And one of the rides at Disney World was called the Buzz Lightyear Space Ranger Spin Ride. We probably set a record for father and son consecutive times on this ride. But when you walk, you know how they herd you like human cattle through the gates and you wait till your turn. And you come around the corner to get on the ride, and there's this life-size robotic Buzz Lightyear kind of moving and talking with a rear projection face saying, "Welcome, Rangers," you know, all this stuff. It was pretty cool. But I just kept moving, and I realized my 5-year-old son wasn't with me anymore. He was still standing back there like this in front of Buzz Lightyear, like, eyes this big, you know? And I said, "Noah, Noah." He turned to me, and he said, "Dad, he's real. I knew he was real," like this. I'm like, okay, come on. People are starting to whisper, you know. Noah has grown out of that condition. We're grateful. It's Resurrection Sunday, Easter morning. It's one of the best and most difficult times to preach. The best because of the sheer power of this message. And challenging because most of you presume to know what I'm going to say before I say it. Blah, blah, blah. Jesus was born, died, rose again. Let's go have eggs. Right? Get on with your day. For many people in our culture, actually, it's like something you grow out of. I used to believe in that stuff, superstition, but I don't have that anymore. I mean, sure, religion's helpful and Christianity's good to a point, but let's not get crazy with all the miraculous talk. I would suggest to you this morning that the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the reality of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, removes stones in our lives. Now, when I say that, most of you probably have an image of the stone in front of the tomb that was rolled away, and you should. But that resurrection morning, the power of it, speaks to some other, no less real, but metaphorical stones that the resurrection deals with, removes from us. The first stone I want to talk to you about, that's what this backpack's all about, is the stone of doubt. We all come in here carrying our own baggage. You look nice. It's Easter. You put on your best. Most of you look fantastic. Some of you are above average, but you all look, you know, pretty good. But we all have our stuff. We all have our backpacks full of stuff. The first stone I want to talk about is the stone of doubt. Some of you come in here and you have doubts about the reality of God, about the love of God. Could he love you? Does he really forgive? Maybe you've been wounded by people who claim to love God and you have your own doubts. And so the first stone I want to talk to you about is the stone of doubt, because the resurrection is only helpful if it's real. Years ago, I read an interview with an author named Anne Rice. Some of you may know Anne Rice. She wrote Interview with a Vampire and the screenplay that became that movie. She was a secular author at the time. She spent her 20s as a skeptic, her 30s and 40s as a hard-boiled atheist. And she came to faith in Jesus Christ. She said one of the pivotal moments for her was reading a book by an author named N.T. Wright. N.T. is Tom Wright. Those are his initials. He's a New Testament scholar. Those are good initials if you're going to be a New Testament scholar. Anyway. He wrote a book, several books, but the book that Anne Rice referred to is called The Resurrection of the Son of God. It's about 770 pages long. It's very academic. There have to be easier ways to come to Jesus, but that's how she's an author. She said reading that book changed her, and I'll quote from her now. She said, "Wright answers the question that had haunted me all of my life. Christianity is what it is purely because Jesus rose from the dead." She gets it. The claims of the Christian faith and of the scriptures can only be helpful to us if this central reality is true, that he really rose from the dead. Or as the Apostle Paul puts this in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 14, he says, "If Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is useless, and so is your faith, and your faith is in vain. Could it be put any more clearly than that? If it's a fairy tale, if it's religious superstition, if it's something we do culturally once a year when we dress up and go to church to please our mom or grandma, what is the point? I should stop talking and you should go home and eat ham. It doesn't matter. But if it's true, it changes everything. If it's true, it changes everything. Now, most of you wouldn't go so far as to say that it's useless or it's pointless. But the prevailing view in our culture is this. You know, the Gospels, we don't know for sure who wrote them. They're doctored over time. They're added to kind of perpetuate this myth. And you can't really trust the reliability. The more important question is not, is it real? The question is, does it work for you? Does it help you? Does the Christian faith make you a better man, a better woman, a better son or daughter, husband, wife, mother, father, employee, employer? Does it help you get on in your life? Does it work for you? But the claim of the Bible is the only way that the gospel message and the Christian life can work at all is if it's true. If it isn't, it has no power to do anything in your life. So the question we should be asking is not, does it work, but is it real? Is it true? Now, we don't have time this morning to go into all of the arguments for why you can trust the reliability of the New Testament accounts of the resurrection, but let me give you just a few things to think about. First, the content of the Gospels themselves, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four Gospel writers, we call them the Gospels, but they're really communicating one Gospel, one message called the Good News. The content of them themselves would be offensive to first century hearers. It would not be the way you would write this story if, in fact, you were reinventing or doctoring history or inventing a story altogether to perpetuate this myth. You'd never write this way. Starting with Jesus' birth, if you want to talk about a Messiah that the whole world would follow, you don't write it that he was born to an unwed peasant girl with a nondescript, nobody Jewish carpenter for a dad in an occupied country. That's not how you write that. That's not what you would invent. That's offensive. Second, the story of his closest followers, the 12 men that were his inner circle, if you were inventing a story to inspire the world, why would you invent that all 12 fall away, that one of the inner circle betrays him, and one of his closest friends, his inner three, would deny even knowing him? You don't write it that way. And finally, his death, his arrest in the garden by religious leaders, how does that inspire people? His beating and mockery of a trial, his flogging in front of a pagan general, a leader, governor, Pilate, and then his crucifixion, dying a criminal's death. These are not things that you sit down to reinvent to inspire the world. And in addition to that, second, the literary style of the Gospels. If you go to Amazon or a bookstore, I don't even know, did anybody go to Barnes & Noble anymore? Do they exist? You just go to Amazon. But if you do, go to a bookstore, and you buy a novel or a piece of fiction, modern fiction writers, modern realistic fiction, they put details in the story to make it feel real to you. That's how today people write fiction. That is not how they wrote stories in the ancient world. Modern realistic fiction didn't exist then. For example, after Jesus' resurrection in John 21, we get the story of him appearing to his disciples while they're fishing. And there are all these details in the account. For example, in 21 verse 7, he wraps his outer garment around him, and a description about the outer garment is given. In 21 verse 8, that he's 100 yards from shore, when they were 100 yards from shore. In verse 9, that he's cooking a charcoal fire of fish and bread for them. In verse 11, that the miraculous catch they had, there were 153 fish. Now, you know, for decades, scholars of the New Testament try to figure out what's the symbolism of 153. It's got to be an important number. What does it mean? 153, what does it symbolize? You know what it symbolizes? I'll tell you. Nothing. It's just they're fishermen, and they count, right? We caught 153 fish, and they wrote it down. They recorded it. The point is, modern fiction includes details to make it feel real, but ancient myths and legends did not. C.S. Lewis writes about this in his book Miracles. I have been reading poems, romances, myths, legends all of my life. I know what they are like, and I know that none of them are like this. Of the gospel accounts, there are only two options for us. They are either historical reportage, or else some ancient unknown writer without predecessor or successor suddenly anticipated the whole technique and genre of modern realistic fiction by hundreds of years. Did you catch that? If you read these accounts, there's only two options. They're either somebody telling you what actually happened, or somehow some unknown writer invented modern realistic fiction without predecessor or successor by hundreds of years, and then it disappeared from the face of the earth for centuries. In other words, somebody's telling you what happened, writing an account for you. Let's go to the Gospel of John, chapter 20, read verses 1 through 10, the account of resurrection morning from John. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved. Now, by the way, John's writing this. You see that phrase, the one whom Jesus loved? That's John's way of talking about himself. Very humble guy. And said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they've laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. This is funny to me. It's like John saying, listen, I know this is about the resurrection, but I just want you to know I'm faster than Peter. Again, you don't write it this way. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up and placed by itself. Then the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in. He says it again, doesn't he? Just in case you missed it, I was there first. And he also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. You want a good reason to believe the reliability of the accounts of the resurrection? You're looking at her. Mary Magdalene. All four gospel accounts tell us that women were there first. And Mary Magdalene was one of the first to see the empty tomb. Nobody living at that time would have written the story, rewritten it, or invented a story with that, with women as the primary witnesses. Why? Well, because in the first century, women were not viewed as credible witnesses. In fact, in some Roman cities, in the Greco-Roman world, women could not testify in court without men backing up their testimony. Celsus, a pagan, anti-Christian Roman historian, writing about 80 years after the resurrection of Jesus, writes that he says basically, the resurrection must not be trusted. The accounts of the resurrection must not be trusted because they rely solely on the testimony of women who, as we all know, are quite hysterical. That's Celsus said that. I didn't say this in case you're... It's far more likely that if the gospel accounts are doctored history, you change that. Or you exclude that. You don't write that in. But there's something else that's really important, I think, and really curious to me. The fact that nobody of Jesus' closest followers seemed to expect the resurrection. Did you ever notice this? 13 times in the Gospels, Jesus says on different occasions, on the third day, the Son of Man will rise from the dead. The Son of Man must be tortured and handed over to be crucified, but on the third day, he'll rise again. After 3 days, I'll rise. On the third day, I'll rise from the grave. After 3 days, I will rise. He says this in Matthew, in Mark, in Luke 13 times. He wants to make this point. Hey, on the third day, I'm going to rise. Don't you think that like the 12 of them would be like outside the tomb, counting it down? You know, they don't have watches, but going 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. It's day 3. Nobody's there. Nobody's looking. You'd think one of them would have said, you know, it's day 3. Maybe we should check just to be sure. Nobody goes. Nobody expects. Nobody looks. Even when the tomb is empty, they don't understand. Why? We tend to think of the people in Jesus' day, the ancient people, as more credulous and superstitious than us. You know, we're modern, enlightened people. We have the advances of technology and science. They, you know, you can forgive them. They didn't understand what we understand now, so they believed these things, which are ridiculous to us. The truth is, nobody was expecting it. Nobody was looking for it. Nobody saw it coming. The resurrection of Jesus was just as inconceivable to the people of the first century as it is to many in our century, but for different reasons. The Greek worldview, to the Greeks, they saw salvation, if they wouldn't use that term, but liberation as the escape from the physical. Plato talked about the difference between the spiritual and the physical, and the Greek worldview was you escape from this physical body. So a bodily resurrection, to come back bodily, made no sense. For the Jewish view, that was that some of them, not all, but some believed in a general resurrection. At the end of all history, Yahweh would bring back all of his faithful. But none of them looked for an individual, specific resurrection of a Messiah. They just weren't looking for it. They didn't expect it. Neither group could conceive of it, and yet there it is. That's why on the morning of the third day, Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb, and she can't make sense of it. Empty tomb, folded claws. What's going on here? But I want to look at two other metaphorical stones that the resurrection removes. But the first realization is, if it isn't real, if you can't come to the realization that it happened, then it has no power in your life to do anything else. And by the way, if this is a struggle for you, I would commend to you a book called The Case for Christ, written by a man named Lee Strobel. And by the way, they made a movie of his story. He was a skeptic and a journalist, and he applied all of his journalistic powers to disprove the resurrection, and that led him to believe that it happened and changed his life. And that movie, I believe, is out in theaters now, and I would encourage you to go see it. The second stone I want to mention, and by the way, these are stones from my neighbor's garden, and I promised I would return them, is the stone of tears. This is one we all carry. Every one of you has a few of these in your backpack. The stone of tears. Let's go back to the story for a minute, verses 11 through 18 with Mary. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" They said to her, excuse me, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. We see this right in the text, the stone of tears. Mary's crying. Why is she crying? If you know anything about Mary Magdalene's story, in Luke chapter 8, we're told that Mary had an affliction, mental disorder, demon possession. She was in a bad way, and Jesus healed her, restored her. She gave up her whole life to follow him, and now her identity, her reason for living had been crucified. She had reason to cry, and she was no stranger to tears even before that. In many ways, Mary is representative of the human experience. We've all got our stone of tears, haven't we? For all of us, if we're honest with ourselves, some of our tears are over things we've done. The shame and the guilt and the baggage we carry for horrible mistakes made, words uttered we can't take back, betrayals that we've committed, sins we've committed, things we wish, we hope no one finds out about, but we carry them. You carry them even now. For some of you, it's maybe not as much things you've done, although that's real, it's things done to you. Things you didn't ask for and didn't deserve, the way people treated you, and you've got a pack full of those. For some of us, it's all that, and it's looking out at the world and seeing just the suffering. I mean, you can get on Facebook and watch cat videos for 10 hours if you want. I wouldn't recommend it. But you can also see the news feed of just the atrocities in the world. What's happening? There are parts of the world where we gather, we put on our Sunday best, you show up here looking sharp, most of you. There are parts of the world where they're dying. Christians are being persecuted and being killed for claiming the name of Jesus. It doesn't cost us much to put on our Easter tie and show up here, but there are parts of the world where people are weeping over loss. My point is, we've all got our stones of tears we carry around. Regret, shame, pain, disappointment, loss. Maybe you feel like your life's just been one disappointment after another, and you've got a pack full of that stuff. I think in Mary's tears is representative of all of us, why we cry. Just this last week, we had our Holy Week communion services on Friday, Good Friday and Maundy Thursday. And in the lobby of the first Good Friday service, I saw a man walk in who I haven't seen in about 3 years. And the last time I saw him, he came for some pastoral counseling, and he unpacked a whole bunch of stones in my office. A lot of pain in his life. And I talked with him and challenged him and encouraged him, and then I never saw him for 3 years. I thought, I didn't know what happened. And he showed up Friday, and he came to the communion table with tears just streaking down his face. And I so badly wanted to talk to him, but I didn't have a chance because, you know, he left before I had a chance to find him. But I got a call from him yesterday. I asked if I could share honestly his story. Just in brief, he told me that he did not expect to meet God that way, but he did. And he believed coming to that table and taking communion for the first time in over 3 years was the beginning of God removing some stones, beginning to liberate his heart from the stuff he's been carrying around. And we all have that. Frederick Buechner says in his book, Telling the Truth, The Gospel as Fairy Tale, Tragedy, and Comedy, he says, the gospel must be bad news before it's good news. It is the news that we are sinners and our world is not right, but it is also the news that we are loved anyway and that our God, our risen King, will one day set the world right. This is the news, the promise we read in Revelation chapter 21, verse 4. He will wipe away, our risen King, every tear from their eyes, and there in death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning or crying or pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. But Mary hasn't gotten there yet, has she? Think about Mary for a minute. Her pain, her grief, and her tears have, in a sense, clouded her vision. She's talking to the risen Jesus. Did you ever think about this? She ran to the tomb to anoint the body, and she's speaking to her Savior, the one that she's grieving over losing, talking to him, and she can't see it. Why? So clouded is her vision, her view of reality by the pain and her past and what's happened that she can't see life accurately. Have you ever felt that way? Do you know people? Loss or disappointment or grief is so clouded their vision that they can't even see any hope at all. They can't see life accurately at all. That's Mary in this situation. She's in the middle of God's greatest victory, and she sees it as a total disaster. Have you ever felt that way? I have. Can you look back on your life and say, this was horrible, and I didn't see at the time, but God was doing his best work. God was doing something miraculous in me, although in the moment, I was in despair. So Jesus asks her a second question. First, he says, why are you crying? The second question, he says, is who are you looking for? What a profound question. Who are you looking for? Who do you seek? You know, in many ways, Mary's looking for the wrong Jesus. Think about it. Why is Mary looking for the wrong Jesus? Because she's looking for the dead one. She's looking for a corpse to treat the body out of honor and respect after the Sabbath. She's looking for the dead Jesus, and the risen one is speaking to her. And she can't see him. Not yet, anyway. This is the final stone. And it's the biggest one. It's the stone of death. This is one that everyone must face, that every one of us carry. The stone of death. Meaning, and I don't mean by this that Jesus removes the stone of death like you don't actually have to physically die. As far as I'm aware, the death rate is holding steady at 100%. It comes for all of us. But it's, what does it mean to us? Is this the great cloud over human existence that we face the abyss? You know, I've been with families in hospital rooms right after or right before they lose a loved one. And as a pastor, you walk in the room and you can feel a difference between those who are still carrying the stone and those for whom it's been taken away by Jesus. I don't mean that they don't mourn or grieve. In 1 Thessalonians 4, the Apostle Paul says, we do not grieve like those who have no hope. It's interesting, he doesn't say we don't grieve. We do grieve. Christians aren't immune to pain. What he says is our grief is different. It's hopeful grief. It feels different. Why? Because that stone is not the final word. It's not the end for us. We don't look into the abyss and wonder, is this the end of all? Is this it? Is this life all there is? The resurrection takes that away and says, no, it's not all there is. This isn't the end. This isn't the final word. In Luke 24, verses 1 through 7, we get this put very plainly for us. This is Luke's account of the resurrection morning. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking spices they had prepared. The they here is the women, Mary Magdalene included. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and on the third day rise? Why do you seek the living among the dead?" That's something I recite at every graveside service. Some of you probably go to gravestones at certain times to remember someone you've lost, to reconnect with that memory, but you're not reconnecting with them. They're not there. This is what the angel says to the women. You can't find him here. Mary's looking for the wrong Jesus, and she's looking in the wrong place, because the stone of death has not yet been taken away. Let me look at verse 16 and 17 again of chapter 20. I'm going to ask this question. When does Mary recognize? When does the penny drop for her? Verse 16. Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." This is a profound statement. But first, what about this question? When does Mary get it? When does she figure out who this is that's speaking to her? Jesus says, "Why are you crying?" She doesn't get it. Jesus says, "Who are you seeking?" She doesn't get it. She says, "Where have they taken him? Tell me and I'll go get the body." When does it make sense? When does she figure it out? When he speaks her name. Isn't that true? When he says, "Mary," her eyes are opened. The lenses of grief and pain are removed, and she sees clearly for the first time, this is Jesus. He's risen. I know some of you here. You know what the truth is? I'm not going to see some of you till next Easter or Christmas, maybe. I know some of you here need to hear Jesus speak your name. You need to hear the risen Savior speak your name and remove the stones out of your backpack and say, "I died for your sin. I died to redeem your life. I died to claim you as my own. I know horrible stuff has happened to you. I know you've got regret in your life of things you've done. I know you've got your questions and doubts." But that's what the resurrection is for, to take that away. Can you hear him speak your name this morning? Maybe you heard it once upon a time, but it's been a long time. That's what happens for Mary. And you notice this part when Jesus says, "Don't hold on to me." Isn't that kind of funny? Like, it's natural, right? She recognizes who he is, and she grabs on Jesus, and she's squeezing him. And the text, Jesus says, "Don't cling to me." The Greek words actually means to grasp tightly. So she's like giving him a bear hug. And Jesus says, "Oh, let go." Why? Because she's hurting him? No. Because Jesus was kind of not a touchy-feely guy and didn't like close body contact? No. Why does he say, "Don't hold on to me"? It's kind of a funny thing, isn't it? Oh, don't touch me. I think he's saying something very profound to us. Mary is holding on. Why? She wants to go back to the way it was. Oh, you're risen. Let's go back to the way it was. And Jesus is saying, in effect, there's no going back. There's only going forward. And what I have in store for you is far better than what's come before. But if you're holding too tightly to this, you can't have what I want to give you. I think that's so true for my life and probably for many of you. We're clutching on to the way it used to be. Parents do this, don't we? Don't you want to freeze time with your kids, right? Hold on to this moment, but you can't. It's like holding water in your hands. Don't you sometimes want to go back to the good old days in your life, whenever those were? And I think God says to us, by the power of the resurrection, there's only going forward with me, and if you'll trust me, it's so much better. What I have for you is so much better. But not, you can't have that if you're holding on to the way it used to be. For many in our culture, and for some of you here today, Easter is not much more than a cultural tradition. It goes along with the stuff we do, right? Eggs. We have Star Wars eggs at our house. Those are cool. Bunnies. Do bunnies lay eggs? I don't think so. Chocolate, family. And I know you're going to leave here and you're going to go have your time, and you should, and you should enjoy it. But once again, the story, the songs we sing about the power of his resurrection, Ryan saying he's risen, us responding he's risen indeed, the text of Scripture which we read every year, what is the point of this if it isn't real? But if it is? But what if it is? But what if it's not talk and cultural tradition and songs we sing once a year? What if he is risen? What if the Lord Jesus Christ really did conquer the grave? What if he really did ascend to heaven? What if right now he really is sitting at the right hand of God interceding for you? What if he's real? And what if he wants to call you by name? I've been praying about this morning that some of you, even though it's familiar territory, would hear again the power of this message, that the risen King, not because I'm saying it, but because he's real, calls you by name and wants to remove all the stuff that is in your way, even your skepticism right now. Take away the lenses so you'd see him maybe for the first time or again for the first time and hear him speak your name and words of grace to your heart. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, you are our risen King. Forgive us for being distracted from that, for doubting it, for losing sight. Thank you for the privilege of gathering together and singing your praises and opening your word and hearing again the incredible, heart-changing, history-altering truth. You are risen. You've conquered all the powers of darkness, not just in our hearts, but in this world. I know there are people here who need to hear you speak to them, who need that power in their lives, and you long to give it. We praise you. We thank you, Jesus, our risen King. Amen. How many of you got goosebumps for that little pause before the last hallelujah? I did. Last hour and this hour, I want them to do it again. Would you do it again?
No.
Next hour, yeah. Once again, we're so glad you've been with us this morning. Let me leave you with this benediction. Brothers and sisters, go in the grace and the power of the risen King. May you hear him speak your name. To him be glory and honor now and forever. Amen. And go in peace.